Syphilis is caused by the spirochete bacterium Treponema pallidum subspecies pallidum. It can be sexually or congenitally acquired. In recent years, there has been a significant rise in cases of syphilis. Initially, mainly confined to urban men who have sex with men, but increasing cases have occurred in young heterosexual Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. Syphilis can be classified into acquired and congenital syphilis. If you look at acquired, it can be primary, secondary, latent, or tertiary. Latent syphilis itself can be further divided into early or late latent syphilis. Then there is tertiary syphilis. Let's talk about primary syphilis. Primary syphilis involves an initial inoculation followed by the development of a macule, papule, and then ulceration with a well-defined margin and indurated base. This is called a chancre. It's usually painless and develops in the anogenital area, the cervix, or the mouth. Hence, it may go unnoticed. It appears 9 to 90 days after exposure, usually around 14 to 21 days, and this is called the incubation period. It is important to remember that a solitary genital ulcer is syphilis unless proven otherwise. There can also be associated non-tender, rubbery, discrete regional lymphadenopathy. The ulcers or the chancre occur in genital sites in 90% of cases and in extragenital sites in 10% of cases. They can be classical in 40% of cases, non-classical in 60% of cases. The syphilitic chancre can be painful in 35% of cases and also can be multiple, particularly in HIV co-infection in 70% of cases. However, it can also be multiple if the patient is not HIV infected in 30% of cases. If untreated, the chancre spontaneously resolves in 3 to 6 weeks. Secondary syphilis usually occurs 3 to 6 weeks after a primary chancre. It involves a rash in 75 to 90% of cases, and the rash affects the body, the palms, and the soles of the feet. It is easily confused with drug eruptions, pityriasis rosea, or gut AIDS psoriasis. It is important to remember it can mimic any rash. There's also generalized lymph node swelling in 70 to 90% of cases. Constitutional symptoms do occur in 50 to 80% of cases, and these include flu-like symptoms, malaise, headache, and fever. In the mouth, you can see mucus patches in 5 to 30% of cases, and there is also condylomata lata in 5 to 25% of cases, and these are raised, flat-top, warty lesions in the genital area. Do look out for patchy alopecia or hair loss in 10 to 15% of cases. There can also be symptoms of neurosyphilis in 1 to 2% of cases, and these include the neurological signs of cranial nerve palsies, particularly cranial nerve H and cranial nerve 2, ophthalmic signs and symptoms, and meningitis. Less commonly, secondary syphilis may present with a hepatitis, arthritis, and nephritis can occur. Secondary syphilis resolves over 3 to 12 weeks, even without treatment, but may recur during the first 2 years. It is important to remember that primary and secondary syphilis overlap in 10% of cases. Next, we look at latent syphilis. This is the long asymptomatic stage of syphilis. It's divided into early latent and late latent. Early latent syphilis occurs within the first 2 years of the initial infection. There is absence of features of primary and secondary syphilis in the history and/or the examination. There is negative syphilis screen in the preceding 2 years. On the other hand, there could be increasing RPR theta by fourfold on subsequent testing without any symptoms within the 2 years. Late latent occurs after the first 2 years. It is defined as cannot be proven to have been acquired within the preceding 2 years, and it's important to exclude cardiovascular and neurosyphilis by physical examination when you are diagnosing late latent syphilis. Then we have tertiary syphilis, which involves locally destructive lesions. There are gummatous lesions And these lesions are granulomatous lesions, most commonly in the skin and bone, which can cause tissue damage and disfigurement. There can also be cardiovascular tertiary syphilis, which occurs 15 to 30 years later. And this involves predominantly large vessel disease with aortic aneurysms and or aortic valve incompetence. Neurological syphilis involves syphilitic meningitis, meningovascular syphilis, cranial nerve palsies, general paresis, and tabes dorsalis. We need to look now at congenital syphilis. This is a multi-system involvement which involves the transmission to the fetus via the placenta. It can be divided into early congenital syphilis, which is from birth to age 2, and late congenital syphilis is after the age of 2. The early signs include characteristic skin lesions, lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly, failure to thrive, a blood-stained nasal discharge, perioral fissures, meningitis, choroiditis, hydrocephalus, seizures, and intellectual disability. There can also be osteochondritis where the long bones and ribs are involved, as well as pseudoparalysis with characteristic radiological changes. The later signs of congenital syphilis include gametous ulcers, periosteal lesions, paresis, tabes, optic atrophy, interstitial keratitis, sensory neural deafness, and very characteristic dental deformities, including Hutchinson incisors, mulberry molars, perioral fissures, and a bulldog facies. There are clinical, microscopic, and serological diagnoses involved. Untreated syphilis in pregnancy will result in stillbirth and neonatal death.